Welcome to the Michigan Runner Show. Join us each time as we explore the people, the places, and the events that shape our great sport.
Hello, everyone. Well, Gary Morgan here with the Michigan Runner, Michigan Travel, on the road again on I-80. Well, I'm driving all the way to Omaha. Well, I'm stopping at the world-famous and world's largest truck stop, Iowa 80. Over 900 trucks can come in here. And, of course, hundreds of cars. There is their sign up there. It's kind of in the sun. World's largest truck stop, Iowa 80. This store is a riot. They have a little bit of everything in it. And I'm running out of time to be inside. I had a little bit of time, but I'll get a little bit on the outside here. A couple other spots here in Walcott, Iowa. There's one of the four major entrances into this place as they go in right there. We'll go in and see just a couple little things before I book out of here. As you can see, hundreds of trucks just along this spot. Pretty cool. Okay, well, trucks supply America with everything. So here is a truck here and the semi behind it that starts in the Statue of Liberty and goes all the way across America. Center of the country, I-80. And there goes to the Rocky Mountains all the way to the San Francisco Golden Gate Bridge. I even crawled into this big rig. They're pretty cool. The sun's kind of messing up the view of it. That's what the control panel kind of looks like. Like an airplane taking off. View of it, Peterbilt. And that's one of these big rigs here. I even got into it, it's pretty cool. This is, as you walk in the main door, the fun facts of Iowa 80. I-80 is the second longest interstate in the USA, 2,900 miles from Teaneck, New Jersey to San Francisco, California. This place serves 5,000 customers a day. All kinds of big jamboree. It says the average long-haul truck driver drives 100,000 miles a year. There are 3.5 million truck drivers in the USA. There's a trucking museum next door. Won't have time for that today. And Iowa 80 has been around since 1964. Here's another view, another part of the store. Like I said, they got everything through here. This is, hey, the superstore out here on I-80 serving truckers and tourist and anybody else driving on I-80. Okay, here's the standard oil pumps, and I see back then, if it was right, back in 1964, gas was 25 cents a gallon. Well, I'm at a rest area just before Des Moines, and here's a little bit of the history of Des Moines, the center of Iowa. It was a fort, and between the Sauk and the Musquot Indians relinquished their rights to surrounding lands in 1846. Des Moines became a capital and became county seat in 80 and capital in 1857. Okay, well, hello everyone. Well, Gary Morgan with the Michigan Runner on the road again. Well, you're over there looking at the Missouri River and the pedestrian bridge to the other side, which is Council Bluffs. This is Omaha. On the other side of the river is Council Bluffs, Iowa. And the city and the Park Service built that beautiful bridge to connect both cities as a pedestrian bridge. I'm here on the city park along Omaha, and we're just going to move right over here, and we're getting ready for the Heartland Marathon here in Omaha. This is the sixth year of this marathon. It was created after a few things happened with the Omaha Marathon. and the Omaha Running Club is doing it. So I've been out here helping out a little bit. And we'll go talk to the race director about this event. This is the start-finish area for the Heartland Marathon.
Hi, good afternoon. I'm Tom Whitaker, president of the Omaha Running Club and race director for the club's Heartland Marathon. This is our sixth edition this year. We started out a number of years ago, and 5 years ago, of course. Obviously, it's a little different this year. We've got the COVID-19 pandemic. We're doing a spacing of the start. We have three different races, so we have three different start times. Requesting that people wear masks. We have special branded masks for the race with the race logo on them. We're asking people to wear those. We're going to do temperature checks as they enter the chutes. We have three or four chutes that will be set up with spacing in between and encouraging people to spread out through that. And we'll kind of start them out slowly, spaced out, and hopefully that will work out fine. Once they get on the course, then if they are wearing masks, they're free to take them off. But we're looking at good weather this year. We had a monsoon that canceled the race at the last minute last year, so we're expecting good weather tomorrow. It's supposed to be cooler than it is today, and we're really looking forward to that. So we're hoping for a good year. Our numbers are down this year, of course, because of the pandemic, but we still have about 440 people right now, and we normally have around 800. So to get half as many as normal under the circumstances, I think is very good, and I'm very happy with it. So we're ready to go.
So tell us about the course. We're running part of it here and part of it in Iowa.
Yes, we crossed the Bob Carey Bridge.
Is that the one right
pedestrian
there?
Bridge, the one right south of us here. Pedestrian bridge between Omaha and Council Bluffs. And then once they cross the bridge, they will go south to a turnaround, come back north, and to another turnaround, and then back across the bridge. The half marathoners and the 10Kers will finish here. The full marathoners will do another loop exactly like the first loop. So that's a little bit different. Obviously, for pure runners, that's not the most ideal course. But under the circumstances, again, this year with a small turnout and so on, trying to avoid streets as much as possible seem to be the thing to do. So anyway, we've got a good certified course, we hope that runners will enjoy it. The view coming back and forth across that Bob Carey pedestrian bridge, particularly coming from east to west, with all of Omaha laid out in front of you, is absolutely spectacular.
I'm over here in Council Bluffs, the sister city to Omaha. I've crossed the river, and I'm at the Union Pacific Railroad Museum. That huge, beautiful building used to be a free public library in its day. Interesting. This was a gift. This library was a gift from Andrew Carnegie, but the Carnegie Mellon, obviously, industrialized giants back in the early 1900s. Quite a structure. Well, anyway, at least it being put to good use. Okay, well, here's a beautiful fountain right across the street from the museum. Absolutely beautiful. I don't see a name on it, but definitely a beautiful structure. Beautiful fountain right here in this beautiful park. And like I said, it looks like another library across the way there. But nice park here in downtown Council Bluffs. Well, I see this is a war memorial park. They have this beautiful memorial here commemorating and honoring the veterans who gave the ultimate sacrifice from the Civil War that the U.S. has participated in, all the way up to the Persian Gulf War and the War on Terror. I'm in the Omaha Union Pacific Railway Station, which is here in Omaha. I had to drive back across the river here to Omaha to check out this beautiful structure. It's a museum now, and it was the original train station here in downtown Omaha. The other one was the museum, and this is a semi-museum here, as people would buy tickets along there in their day. And this is called the Great Hall over here. This used to be the diner here. At the train station. Here's the whole train station. There's a few things about the Union Station here. Of course, in the 30s, 40s, and 50s, the Union Station was definitely the meeting place. And people traveled by train all across America. Well, the last train departed out of this station in 1971 with passengers. And then they turned it into a museum. That's here, the soda fountain at the Durham Museum opened in 31. And it went till 70. Well, that happened in 31. Eating on the go. One of the talking statues. It says here back in its day, 10,000 people a day passed through these doors. Sure was a busy place in its day, no doubt about it. One of the big steam locomotives. It's called the Union Pacific 1243. And there it was, built in 1890. This is what used to roll through here back then. Wowee. What an engine. Yep, there it all is. And the ever famous caboose right behind it. This is on the lower floor of the museum here. And before gasoline powered cars, coal fueled the chugging steam locomotives. The 1243 used almost 2.5 tons of coal per day during its 120-mile round trip between Columbus and Spalding, Nebraska. That's almost 2 compact cars in weight. The engineer would slow down or speed up the engine as necessary and instruct the fireman when the locomotive needed more steam. The fireman shoveled coal into the fire, heat in the boilers and powering the locomotive. How tired would your arm be if you had to shovel the weight of 2 cars into firebox every day? Mighty tired, to say the least. That's what it was back then. It was nothing but work. Pretty cool. Who's here? And I love it. Union Pacific. Their motto, we will deliver. Great motto. And here's great, lots of things about the Union Pacific. By all the different rail lines they had. Well, there was an electric car built in 1920 by Rauch and Lang. An electric car, even way back then. So, electric cars were made during the 1910 event up to date. Electric cars are far more numerous than gasoline-powered cars. An overview of Omaha. All the rail lines here. Kind of cool. We're in the building to the far right there. Well, we have the mighty bison here, but we have Mutual of Omaha. When I was a kid growing up, there would always, every Sunday night, there'd be Mutual of Omaha, the Wild Kingdom or something like that. It would show different wildlife shows from around the world, a lot from Africa, but many times from the Wild West, the Mutual of Omaha Wildlife Series, every Sunday night. Omaha became a city, or at least a territorial capital, in 1855. Some of the timeline of Omaha. Union Pacific breaks ground in 1863. And in 1867, Nebraska becomes a state and moves the capital to Lincoln. So those are some of the historical early facts of Omaha. The history of Berkshire Hathaway. Well, in 1 weekend in May, Omaha becomes a world financial center. Financial experts from around the globe descend in Omaha. The annual Berkshire Hathaway shareholders meeting. It was a textile company when it started, but everything changed when Warren Buffett bought the company in 1965 and expanded it, and they've got everything. Beer companies in Omaha. They had three major brewers, Metz Brothers, Dortz Brewing Company, and Fred Krug Brewing Company. All three were locally owned. Omaha was the territorial capital in 1855, but just a few years later, the state capital was formed in 1867, and it was moved to Lincoln, about 60 miles west of here. Trade, and then the Lewis and Clark era, starting in 1804, and headed for the Wild West, westward expansion, Jefferson's vision. Definitely had to be a wild time hiking across America in 1804. Lots of different settlers. There was the Pike's Expedition. He took two or three, and then the Long Expedition. The Louisiana Purchase changed America more than by any other purchase. The nation's new backyard in 1803. It was agreed upon with the French, and after that, it was all history from there. Wagon trains like this transported settlers across America by the hundreds of thousands back then. Immigrants from around the world flocked to Omaha in the 1800s and early Nebraska by promise of jobs, land, and ownership, and the freedom to live and worship as they choose. African, Chinese, Czech, Danish, English, German, Greek, Irish, Italian, Jewish, Lithuanian, Mexican, Polish, Scottish, Swedish, Welsh. A patchwork of everybody. In America, we're all hybrids. We're all a little mix of everything. The immigrant groups, how things changed, early 1900s, between white man and the Native Americans, between blacks and whites, women to vote, racial divide. More things change, the more they stay the same. Here is a Pennsylvania Oils. Here is a gas pump from back then, from the 1920s. The interesting part of this museum, Brian Reed, who was started his real estate company here in 1856, and he collected coins from around the world. And so when he died, he gave them to the library, and then the library donated them to this museum for us to see a beautiful, like I said, coins and medals from various events, people, whatever, over the years. What they're most famous for is the rodeo and Omaha Steaks, the backbone of Omaha's economy, the heyday of the stockyards. Well, a complete huge train set they have here, depicting parts of Omaha and the bluffs behind them. Okay, well, here is the outside of the Omaha Union Station, which is now the Durham Museum. Okay, well, here's the very front of the train station, the Omaha Union Station, and now it is called the Durham Museum, the centerpiece of Omaha. Well, may not be coming out quite as good as I like, but we are here at the Ameritrade Park, and it is home of the College World Series for the NCAA. Also, it is home of the Creighton baseball team. So anyway, and they have a backdrop right there of Union Pacific, one of the big sponsors, obviously, of this park. and but it's right here on a busy corner, and all four sides has got these kind of steeple type things saying Omaha on them. So and then that's a big hospital to the right here, and we'll be down on the riverfront again. Like I said, another hazy day is between smoke from out west and maybe raining tonight. It's a hot day, supposed to cool off tomorrow for the marathon. But anyway, this is Omaha. It's truly a nicer city than what you would think. And okay, well, I'm here at the base of the Senator Bob Carey Bridge. This is a pedestrian bridge across the Missouri River, and we will be running across that. And here's the Missouri River. We start down the way here, but less than a mile, and then we cross over this bridge over to Council Bluffs and run along the river path for miles down the way and then turn around. So anyway, here's the mighty Missouri River, and that tent way down the way there, that white tent. Well, that's just before the start area of the race. So beautiful warm day here in Missouri, and on the Missouri River, Nebraska, Iowa border here. Here on the John Carey Bridge. People on the bridge here, view of Omaha, and there goes on down the way. Bridge here, and we're on the Iowa-Nebraska line. Anywhere, there's the baseball stadium. A great view of it right next to that mural. Beautiful spot here. Hanging out under the John Carey Bridge here in Omaha. Oma the Troll statue was made possible thanks to a grant from Douglas County Visitor Improvement Fund and is dedicated to all believe a troll can inspire a visitor's imagination. Sculptured by John Libja, 2019. Well, the inspiration of traveling. A view underneath the bridge here. Kind of cool. All the way across. There it all goes. What's kind of cool here with this building here and this bridge, this is all part of the Lewis and Clark National Historic Trail. And this is the visitor center for it, and of course other parks in the area. But the trail is 4,900 miles long around America. So 4,900 miles of hiking across America to see what it's all about. Well, good morning, everyone. Gary Morgan with the Michigan Runner. Well, you see the bright light there. Well, that is the start and finish area of the Heartland Marathon. Well, there's volunteers getting it ready. There it is, the start area, which we'll be hitting in just probably about 45 more minutes. And there's the Bob Carey Bridge all lit up at night. It's just after 6 a.m., part of downtown Omaha there. Right on the Missouri River. Here comes one of our finishers. Good job, man. Hey, how was it out there?
Oh, it was good. Weather was great.
Oh. Rained in by too many people.
Not Carol as bad. Schilling from Appleton.
Here comes
Wisconsin.
A young lady coming in. Congratulations. These 5-hour finishers. Here comes another finisher in. 5:15, a marathon maniac. Here she comes
Narrow
in.
Neck, New York.
Awesome. Came in from New
Whoa.
York. Congratulations.
New York City.
How are you?
Doing good.
Good.
Congratulations. Good job.
Thanks.
Yes. Okay. Yeah, this is great. This is Karen from New York. I interviewed her when she did her 100th marathon in Wineglass, we believe in 2017. This is her 190th. So, Karen, what was it like running your 190th marathon out here in Nebraska, Iowa?
You know, it's always pretty awesome at the finish line, so of course I have all good things, but during it, it, and I was like, what am I doing? It's my 29th marathon of the year, believe it or not, even
29.
After... Yeah.
Where even, are you finding all these races?
Carly,
thanks to him.
Omaha, congratulations, and Glenn. Welcome to the finish line.
How do you find all the races?
Runninginthe.USA.com.
Running in the USA.
Yeah, they keep it pretty much up to date. It's up to date pretty much.
What's the marathon next week?
Montana.
Did you guys go into Montana?
Next week.
50K in Montana.
We've been going every weekend since like the end of May.
So you guys retired and just going to races?
No.
So you're going back to New York to go to work?
I've actually been working from home from Virginia.
Okay. She moved to Virginia.
And now pretty much I've moved.
So you're flying out to Montana next week?
Yeah. Then the following week we got two. We got Missouri and Illinois that weekend. So.
Awesome.
He's a hard act to follow. You know, my last name is Murray. They call me Murray in a hurry.
Yes.
But I don't know. I found my...
Well, so what's your last name?
Anderson.
What's your first name?
Glenn.
Well, great meeting both of you. Good luck in your races.
Thank you.
What's your name?
I'm Mariana Phipps.
And I hear you are the one who put this together.
Well, the three of us have done this for several years. Glenn is a newbie.
I'm a newbie.
We had to
they invited me into the group.
Well, no, we have another man. Jose, come on over here. This is our lead runner
I heard he's 82.
He's interviewing
So what's your name?
My name's Jose Badillo.
And I hear you're part of this women's group of over 70.
they should be over 80. Because I'm over.
I hear you're over. You're the fast guy. Yeah, you got it. So how many years have you done this?
This is our fifth year.
Fifth year.
Yeah.
Awesome. And who's the fast person here?
He is.
The old guy.
Well, more experience.
Well, that's true.
Yes, he's had more time to practice.
And then are all of you right here from Omaha?
Yep.
Well, cool. And
No. I'm from Bellevue.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Well, she is too.
Okay, it's pretty close.
Yes.
How far is that from here? 10 miles?
Probably 23.
23. Still close. Well, the question is, are you going to do this again next year?
Absolutely.
We sure as heck hope so.
That's what I like to hear.
I'll have to think about it.
Okay. Well, we have somebody who's very happy here. She just qualified for Boston in the adapted division, so she'll tell us a little bit about it. And what's your name?
So my name's Sagira Med Norris. I came from Houston, Texas. I have progressive multiple sclerosis, and I was treated with HSCT in Mexico with high doses of chemo. And last year I was in a wheelchair using a cane, and I just finished a marathon so that I can go to Boston.
Well, congratulations. That is so fantastic.
And I'm so lucky. I brought my friend with me to pace for me so that she can also run Boston, where she's from. And I couldn't have done anything without my friend Kelly. And I'm so thankful for Heartland, because we had four races cancel on us. And
Kelly, come on over here.
And I never thought we'd actually get to one.
Well, and today almost got canceled when this...
I know! I was so like, because Fargo cancels, and then Bismarck, and I don't know, someplace in Ohio, we didn't even know where we were going. And I'm just so, so thankful this went off and that we finished, and everyone is just so nice. And Omaha is more than I ever thought was actually here.
Yeah, that's a great town.
It is.
It really is. Yeah.
So, really proud.
Well, Kelly, tell us how you guys met.
Ironically, we live in Houston about 10 minutes from each other, but we met on Facebook because we're both runners and Disney fanatics.
Oh, okay.
So it was a Run Disney Houston group on Facebook that brought us together, and it was almost 5 years ago, I'd say.
Oh, 5 years
ago. Yeah, it's been an amazing ride ever since, but I'm just so honored to be by this girl's side. I mean, the strength she has just is unbelievable. Yeah.